And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain.
We get a lot of people who are interested in museums per se, just the general curiosity. What the heck is a Toby jug, and how is there a museum, and why? If you're a collector, you can't help but like this. And if you feel guilty about your own collecting habits, then all guilt goes when you see what Steve did.
I did it my way.
A Toby jug is actually originated as a beer container. Think of them as a pitcher, a jug, used for carrying water, but the first ones were used for beer. Toby Philpot was this really large, rotund squire who was known throughout the land for his wit and rank on tour. He was also known for drinking an awful amount of beer. There was a beer called Stingo. He's meant to have drunk 60,000 gallons in his lifetime. And about the same time that he died, there was a song came out about how his spirit flowed into a brown jug. And we think at that time the first Toby jugs appeared. It's not certain exactly why they were called Toby. Some people think it had something to do with Shakespeare and Toby Belcher. Some people think it had to do with High Toby and Low Tobies, which were the highwaymen. Me, I like Toby Philpot. Steve, who founded the museum, was a passionate collector. He started at the age of 14, and he collected for over 70 years. Sadly, he passed away earlier on this year at the grand old age of 87. But he had a wonderful life. This was a great passion of his. He traveled all around the world collecting. He researched on pieces, published several books on pieces. Steve was a human dynamo.
At summer camp, he would use his commissary money to buy the jugs for his mom. And he would bring them back every summer. I think he bought 5 jugs every summer and brought them back. And after a few years, my grandmother said, well, this is obviously your collection. And when he was in the army in 1954 to 56, he brought a whole trunk full home. And that was what really, I think, jump-started his huge fascination and collection with the jugs.
He was a man possessed. So he started in our house, and I went out one day and he opened the wall and made an opening for Toby jugs. I said, no Toby jugs on that wall. You have to go somewhere else with these Toby jugs.
There was just one showcase. Steve moved it into his office. As the years went on, Steve became more successful in real estate. The office got bigger. More and more cabinets started getting added. Eventually, after 70 years, we end up with 101 showcases.
He started traveling to buy the jugs, and he'd bring them back with him, and he ended up having lots of friends, a lot of English friends and some French friends that we've stayed in contact for all these years.
Steve and I have known one another since the 1980s. I'm a bit of a Toby jug fanatic, just like Steve. It was a great friendship started from that point. We get into the early 90s, and I'm doing a collectible show in California, and I met a girl that I married and moved to Chicago. And so suddenly I'm in Chicago and Steve's in Chicago, and I have a little office that's importing pieces, and Steve says, why don't you set up a shop? And I thought, well, that might be an interesting idea. And then he goes, and I can put the museum in the shop. So it continued to grow, it started taking over part of my shop, and he developed the building solely for the purpose of having the museum in the basement.
I think when you talk about my dad in general, people who even knew him casually knew quite a bit about him because he did wear his passions on his sleeve. They're like, if you knew Steve even barely at all, you knew he went to Dartmouth, you knew he loved green, you knew he was bald, he drove in a convertible, he didn't care if it was cold out, he didn't care if he was getting skin cancer on his nose, he was like, I want the sun on my head.
Huge passion for musicals and Broadway shows, and always had all of us going and paying for our tickets, and very generous. He was really sort of a Renaissance man in a lot of ways.
He got to live pretty much right up until he died. I think he was very much into his own accomplishments, not in like a braggy way, but it was what kept him going.
He was a world-class swimmer, and Even a year before he died, they got 4 national records in relays in their age group, 85 to 89. And 2 years before he died, he got his first ever gold medal in the World Swimming Championships in Budapest.
Sadly, we sort of knew at the time that cancer had already arrived, but he still swam and he still won. It was very joyful, and it was only right that he actually got it after so many years of trying and supporting and training. That was really a highlight for all of us. The mission statement of the museum is to share the collection and to promote the concept of Toby Jug collecting. But you've got to have a sense of humor to collect Toby Jugs. Steve's funeral, at the end, his ashes were carried out to the tune of I Did It My Way in one of his Toby Jugs, which was just a really fitting end to a wonderful celebration of the man's life.
Yes, it was mine.